In this talk, I'd like to highlight the importance of group delay calibration for Wi-Fi ranging systems based on 11AZ and 11MC. Wi-Fi ranging relies on measuring the round trip time or RTT between an initiator device and a responder device. For this purpose, the 11MC standard introduced fine timing measurement. This process involves the responder sending a frame to the initiator. The responder records the time of departure T, 1 of this frame, and the initiator records the time of arrival T, 2. This is followed by the initiator sending a frame to the responder and let T3 and T4 be its corresponding time of departure and time of arrival respectively. Finally, the responder shares the measured T1 and T4 to the initiator in another frame. The initiator then computes the round trip time using this equation. Once the RTT is known, the range can be determined by multiplying half the RTT with the velocity of light. It then follows that a 1 nanosecond error in RTT estimate results in a 0.15 meter range error. Therefore, it is crucial to measure the timestamps with high accuracy and every nanosecond counts. The 11AZ amendment has some enhancements to complete all the frame exchanges in a secure manner and in a single transmit opportunity. Additionally, 11AZ addresses the problem of estimating the time of arrival of a frame accurately in a multipath environment. With multipath, the receiver receives multiple delayed replicas of the same frame, and this can really confuse a receiver regarding the exact time of arrival. This uncertainty in time of arrival is resolved in 11AZ using channel estimates obtained with an NDP frame. That's a high-level introduction to 11MC and 11AZ, but the focus of this talk is a different problem. Every Wi-Fi device consists of a MAC layer which is implemented with digital circuits and a radio which comprises of some digital signal processing logic and some analog circuits for the transmitter and receiver. Let the propagation delay between the responder antenna and initiator antenna be delta P. The problem is that during the FTM exchanges, the timestamps T1, T2, T3 and T4 are recorded only in the digital MAC layer, whereas we should really be recording them at the antennas. The transmitter and receiver circuits inside the radio do contribute some delay, which we call as group delay. The group delays of the transmitter and receiver at the responder and initiator side get added to the RTT estimate as shown in this equation. The solution to this problem is to perform group delay calibration to measure the sum of the transmitter and receiver delays. The initiator is responsible for removing its group delay contribution from T2 and T3, while the responder is responsible for removing its group delay contribution from T1 and T4. There are multiple ways to do this calibration. For example, we can measure RTT while placing initiator and responder at a known distance and then subtract the expected RTT from it to obtain the group delay contribution. Another way is to have some kind of special transmitter to receiver loopback mechanism inside the radio to measure the group delays. These calibration methods are proprietary to the Wi-Fi chipset vendor and are not part of the Wi-Fi standard or Wi-Fi Alliance certification. The Wi-Fi Alliance test cases for 11MC and 11AZ only concern protocol compliance and not the RTT ranging accuracy. It is important to note that any errors in group delay calibration will cause a range error. Recall that every nanosecond counts. From my experience, the RTT ranging accuracy is only as good as the group delay calibration accuracy. To understand the challenges in accurate group delay calibration, we need to go deeper inside the radio. Here is a simplified block diagram of the radio internals. There is a digital baseband block where all the digital signal processing like automatic gain control, channel estimation, modulation, demodulation, etc. happen. There are also several filters, mixers, and amplifiers which are analog circuits. The group delay of the digital components are constant and do not change from part to part, whereas the group delay of the analog components vary part to part. Therefore, group delay calibration has to be done for every hardware unit during the manufacturing process. Among all the components, the filters usually contribute a significant group delay. Note that group delay is inversely proportional to the filter bandwidth, and group delay increases with the filter order. So, lesser the bandwidth, more the group delay. Similarly, higher the stop band attenuation of the filter, higher is the group delay. Now, some of the analog blocks are implemented using active circuits instead of passive circuits in order to realize some gain. This is especially true of the receiver, since it needs to handle a large dynamic range to cater to strong as well as weak signals. The highlighted analog blocks can therefore be variable gain stages, whose gain setting is controlled by the automatic gain control or AGC logic in digital baseband. The AGC uses a low receive gain setting for strong receive signal strength and high receive gain setting for low receive signal strength. Now, what happens if the group delay varies with the gain setting? It turns out that some analog circuit implementations do have gain-dependent group delay. This will add another level of complexity to the calibration process, as we now need to repeat the calibration at different RX gain settings. This will increase the calibration time during manufacturing. And people in the hardware manufacturing space will tell you that time is money at the factory floor. Moreover, there needs to be special provision in the implementation for receive gain dependent group delay compensation. So when we receive a frame, we need to record the receive gain, look up for its corresponding group delay, and compensate the T1, T2, T3, T4 accordingly. Suppose that the group delay calibration is performed at a single RX gain setting corresponding to a distance of 2 meters. The estimated range plot might look like this from 0 to 2 meters distance. But beyond 2 meters, the estimated range starts deviating from the actual distance, because with increasing distance, the receive signal strength drops, the RX gain increases, and its group delay differs from the calibrated group delay. In summary, it is not sufficient for devices to simply support 11MC or 11AZ. Group delay calibration should be performed for each hardware unit during manufacturing to achieve the best Wi-Fi ranging accuracy. The group delay in general changes with bandwidth, frequency band, and the receive gain. Finally, gain-dependent group delay compensation is recommended for the best results. Thank you for listening, and see you all in the next one.